morning. My name is Dana Hall. I'm a volunteer organizer with Our Revolution Bergen County. I also happen to be a member of this congregation, Temple Bethel. And I'd like to welcome you. A little bit of housekeeping information first. There is a restroom, handicap accessible, right behind this door. And there's also more restrooms downstairs in the lobby if you don't want to wait and you're willing to walk back downstairs. Emergency exits in case we need them. If you go through the kitchen here, you can get out of the building quickly in case we need to do that. Everybody should be aware of that. There are snacks for sale for donation to help us offset the cost of hosting tonight's event right in the back of the room. So please avail yourselves of those delicious snacks. There's literature on the right-hand side, a lot of great material about the topics that we're going to be hearing about tonight, as well as the packets on each of your chairs. Also, we really want this to be an interactive forum, so we're going to ask you if you have questions. Mr. Al Grinnell, who's in the back of the room, has index cards and pens, and he's going to come around and pass them to you. We can collect your questions, or you can come up to the microphone and ask your question in your own voice, whatever you're comfortable with. We're going to build question and answer time into each after each speaker. But please be aware that if you have a burning question, we're going to try to get to it, so fill out those cards. I'd like to thank my fellow Our Revolution team members and the other organizations that are co-sponsoring this event. This is such an important topic and so timely, right? I mean, what's happening, like, even right now? What is Mitch McConnell doing behind that closed door? So we're here today to talk about what the right answer should be for the, our healthcare future. And it, rather than just opposing the bad stuff, we should come up with the right stuff. And we have an amazing panel of speakers here who are gonna help us understand these issues. So what I'm gonna do is quickly describe each of the speakers in one fell swoop, and then call the first one up. So first we have Dr. Margaret Flowers. You guys have a bio of her, but Dr. Flowers is a pediatrician who has been advocating full-time for single payer since 2007. She also, what's not in her bio here, she ran for Senate in the great state of Maryland last year in the Green Party, and she has been active on this issue and a national speaker, much sought after. So we really appreciate you coming up from Maryland and joining us tonight. I'm going to skip the next person because he's not here yet. We have Assemblyman John Wisniewski to my left. John ran a courageous campaign in the primary just a week or two ago and was endorsed by Our Revolution Bergen County and a couple of other local chapters for the governor's candidacy. We're particularly proud of John's advocacy for a single-payer health care plan for the state of New Jersey. And we're very excited to hear from John about that. We also have to John's left, Mr. Frank Huig, whose bio is in the packets. Frank, I know, is, I see Frank all over Facebook. And everything happens on Facebook, right? And the activism and keeping in people's radar screen is such an important thing in this effort, and Frank is a wonderful activist. Okay, now I have his bio. Frank has been working on co-sponsoring an objective to get the House Resolution 676, which is Elijah Cummings' bill for single payer at the national level. Frank's going to tell us about his national campaign to get that done and work with House representatives on that on a national level. And we have Reverend Seth Copperdale, who is a candidate for governor for the Green Party. He did not have to run in the primary, so he is an active candidate for governor and a great supporter also of single payer and many other wonderful issues that are so important to people and humanity. And so thank you for being here and looking forward to hearing from you. donated in the donation jar to help us offset the cost. Thank you for that. And Dr. Flowers, I'm going to ask you a comment.
All right, thank you so much. So there's a lot to say, and if you'll let me know when I have about a minute or so left, that'll be great, because I could easily stand here and talk for a long time. But I really appreciate being invited here tonight and all of you coming out at this time. It's such an important time to be working on this. I want to thank Dana and Ariane for organizing this event tonight. So I'll start right in. The first point that I wanted to make is that the United States doesn't actually have a healthcare system. In the history of our country, nobody actually ever sat down and said, let's design a healthcare system that would actually cover everybody and improve the health that we have. Much of what we have right now has been kind of a series of unfortunate events, you might say, that my kids used to read when they were young. After World War II, there was the linkage of health insurance with employment, and now that hasn't worked very well for us here in the United States, because when people have a serious health problem and they can't work, they're at risk of losing their health insurance at the time they need it the most. And then in the 1970s, another kind of important point to know was the Health Maintenance Organization Act of 1973, signed into law by President Nixon, allowed entities to profit off of health care. So it moved health care from a public service, which it had been up until that time, to being an entity for profit. And during the Reagan administration, Wall Street investors were literally brought into the Department of Health and Human Services and trained on how to take over health care as a fertile profit-making field. So this is a real point of departure from the United States to most of the other industrialized countries around the world. Now, the Affordable Care Act was an attempt to kind of tinker with this current system and see if it could be made to work better, that maybe if we make everybody buy health insurance and we give the health insurance companies a lot of money, they'll accept some regulations and actually start paying for health care. But what we found is that no matter what we do with the private health insurance companies, they find a way to get around it, quite literally. So premiums continue to go up, out-of-pocket costs continue to go up. We're seeing a growing, there was a study that just came out, I think it was last week, looking at the trends of how many people have what are called high-deductible health insurance plans, and showing that in employer-based plans and individual market plans, those are really growing. And one of those are plans where people have to pay thousands of dollars out of pocket before their insurance kicks in. And along with that study, they looked at how many people were avoiding or delaying necessary care and found that there were very high proportions of people with these high deductible plans that were just delaying care that they needed or avoiding it altogether. So we're seeing through the Affordable Care Act an erosion of what we thought was gold standard of health insurance, employer-based plans, and more employers are moving towards these high deductible plans. I know that the Affordable Care Act covered more people, and that's a good thing, but unfortunately, with that, the industry has continued to behave the way that it does. The American Health Care Act, it's showing that it's very difficult for the United States to move any further in the direction of a market-based system, because the people are quite literally saying, no, you cannot go any farther. We're not going to tolerate a worsening of our private health insurance. We're going to not tolerate tens of millions of more people going without insurance. So it's an interesting moment that we have right now that people are saying, no, we need to do the right thing. We need to finally, you know, get down to serious business and say, why don't we enjoy the rest of the industrialized world? Why don't we finally create a universal healthcare system, treat healthcare as a public good? We're paying for it. The United States spends twice as much per person per year on healthcare as most other industrialized countries, and they cover everyone, they have better health outcomes. So it's an interesting moment. Of all the years that I've been doing this, I left practice in 2007 to do this full time, but I've been advocating prior to that. I've never seen such energy, that people are just coming from all different areas and saying, you know what, this is a priority, we need to fight for a national improved Medicare for All system, and that's a great thing, that's really exciting. And we're at this moment, I think, where we as a people have to decide, is healthcare a commodity? Is it like a phone or whatever, clothing and TV? Or is it a public service? Because we can't treat it as both at the same time. We have to treat it as one. And unfortunately, as long as we have the private insurance companies in the system, it's going to be treated as a commodity. So that's why we advocate for National Improved Medicare for All. Let me talk a little bit about what I mean by National Improved Medicare for All. There's a lot of misinformation out there about what it is and what it isn't, and it is interesting to see how much media single payer is getting right now, good and bad. So an easy way to think about it is it's national. Every single person living in the United States, every single health professional in the United States is in the system. Wherever you go in the United States, you're in the system. If there is a specialty center that's not in your state and you need to go there, it's in your network. You can go there. So, you know, and as we travel around, we don't have to worry about going out of the network. If you have a doctor or a health professional that you like, you don't have to worry about your insurance changing and that person no longer being in your network. So it's a national system. It's improved because Medicare, unfortunately, has been under attack for several decades now and it's been eroded and is not comprehensive and requires co-insurance and co-pays and deductibles. And so under improved Medicare for All, it would be comprehensive. It would cover all medically necessary care, including long-term care. Many seniors may experience that when you need long-term care, you have to spend down your money to qualify for Medicaid, to get Medicaid to cover your long-term. So that would be included, as well as mental health, dental, vision, hearing, pharmaceuticals, all the things that we need. And then it's Medicare for All. Like our current Medicare, it's paid for upfront through taxes. So we're each paying in, and then when we need it, we just go to our health professional. We don't have to worry about whether we can pay for the copay or whatnot. We just focus on care. Literally, you can walk in the door, and as it is in most other industrialized nations, the first question will be, why are you here? Not, what is your insurance card? Do you have your copay with you? So, you know, something that we don't experience here in this country, and we don't recognize how abnormal that is. And it's Medicare for All. It's for every person for your entire life from the moment of conception until you die. And the nice thing about it, the legislation that we advocate for, H.R. 676, which is actually John Conyers' bill, the Expanded and Improved Medicare for All Act, says if a person arrives for health care, they are presumed to be in the system and care is given first, and then they can be registered in the system afterwards. So that's a pretty good thing. All right, so we're already paying for health care for everyone. We're spending twice as much. We have public on our side. Poll after poll for decades has shown that the majority of people in the United States, the majority of health professionals, support a National Improved Medicare for All or single-payer system. What is standing in the way? Well, when we go to Congress, we're always told we don't have the votes. So I look at it this way. There's two realities. There's the reality, and there's the political reality. And the reality is that our healthcare crisis is not going to be solved until we get the profiteering out of our healthcare system and use those dollars instead to pay for health. The political reality can change. That's something that people have power to change. We just came out of fighting the Trans-Pacific Partnership, another secret thing behind closed doors that was being negotiated under the Obama administration. And we fought for 6 years to defeat that. And we did. We shifted the political culture around the Trans-Pacific Partnership so that literally people like Senator Rob Portman, a Republican who sits on the Senate Finance Committee from Ohio, who was a former U.S. trade representative and a strong proponent of the TPP, was running away from it by the time that the elections were coming around. So this is something that we have the power to change, and we have to recognize that. But we have a very, give yourself a hand. We have the power. We have a very formidable foe. We have the medical-industrial complex. And there's a huge revolving door in Washington, D.C., between the staffers in Congress and lobbyists in the health industry, as well as other industries. They pay a lot of money for campaigns. They send a lot of lobbyists in there. In 2009 and 10, during the health reform process, they were spending over $1 million a day, the health insurance companies were lobbying that legislation. And they have a lot of ways of kind of taking us off track and distracting us. So you so often hear that our healthcare costs are our fault, that we're too sick, we're too irresponsible, we don't take care of ourselves, and it's all our fault that the system is not working. It has nothing to do with all those profiteers that are taking a lot of money out of it. So we have to recognize that it is a system-wide problem and not accept that blame, that, you know, when we're spending a third of our healthcare dollars on bureaucracy because of all of these different insurance plans that we have, when we're spending the most on pharmaceuticals in the world, the most on health services in the world, because we don't have a system that negotiates for fair prices, that's the real cost of why our healthcare system is the way it is. It's not our fault. And in fact, in other countries that have worse health habits, they have more smoking, more alcohol use, actually have, they spend less, and they have longer life expectancies and better health outcomes, while they have universal healthcare systems. Another thing that the medical industrial complex will do is they'll find all of these other plans that our members of Congress could be doing instead of single payer and try to convince us that we're asking for too much, but we could have this. So they float out things like a public option. And I think it's really important for us to understand that the so-called public option, which would be a public insurance that would theoretically compete with these private health insurers, is not a solution. It has been tried at the state level over and over again, and each time what happens is that the private health insurers are very good at hanging on to the healthy patients, and people who have health problems are incentivized to go into these public plans, and then the public plans always fail under the burden of actually having to pay for health care. And there was an article we posted on the Hope website today. Senator Lindsey Graham actually said that he was floating an idea that why don't we give Medicare to everybody that has a pre-existing condition? Literally recognizing that the private health insurance companies do not want to have anything to do with people that actually have health problems, and so they can keep insuring all the healthy people that don't need any health care, but as soon as someone needs health care, they can go into Medicare. Now, is that ridiculous or what? I think we need to start calling private health insurance the healthy profiteer insurance or something like that, because it has nothing to do with health. The other thing is a Medicare for some. They keep trying to convince us that, oh, well, we'll let people buy into Medicare, and then that will move us into a Medicare for all system. And we know, again, that when you do these opt-in systems, they don't work. And the only way that we get the money to actually take care of everybody is to have that single-payer system where we collect all the money in one risk pool and then have a very simple administrative cost. Medicare spends about 2-3% of its dollars on administrative. Compare that to the 30% or so that we're spending now because of the system that we have. So that gives us billions, hundreds of billions of dollars a year in savings that we can use to pay for actual care. So we have to make sure that we don't get fooled by these false paths. So how do we win? Well, we know from decades, over 100 years of research of how social movements succeed, that when you have national consensus on an issue, when you have 3.5% of the population mobilized on that issue, that you can win on that issue. So what we need to do is create a broad movement. We call it a movement of movements, because we need to recognize that health care is connected to so many issues. It's connected to wealth inequality. It's connected to, we have health disparities based on gender, based on race in this country, so it's connected to those issues. The social determinants of care have much more of an impact on our health than access to health care. So things like your level of education, whether you have clean water to drink or healthy food to eat, or you have public transportation or a job with a living wage, these have a huge impact on our health. And so this is all connected. And by that's what we did when we won the TPP fight, but we showed various groups, the people that were worried about GMOs, or worried about labor rights, or the environment, or internet freedom, that this was all connected. We created a huge movement of movements that won that fight. We need to do the fundamentals of educating ourselves and others, organizing in our communities, and then mobilizing and things. What's interesting is that we don't have to do so much of educating people in terms of building national consensus on this, because we already pretty much have that. And actually, people are coming out of the conservative wings and saying, we get it, that, you know, this is the solution. And now we have business leaders coming on board through the Business Leaders Transforming Healthcare. But we have to educate ourselves is that we have the power to do it and how we do that. People have been beaten down for so long and told, we've always tried for that, but we're never going to get it. We're never going to get the votes. We have to not accept that. And so that actually brings me to three lessons that I learned when I was volunteering as the Congressional Fellow of Organizations for National Health Program during the health reform process in 2009 and 10. And the acronym for the three lessons is ICU. And so as a health professional, I think, okay, we have a healthcare crisis and we need ICU. Mm-hmm. Intensive care unit is what we use it in the medical field. So the I stands for independent. When it comes to this issue, we have to focus on this issue independent of political party and recognize that no matter who is in office, we have to fight for this. If we recognize that when we had a Democratic majority in the White House and in Congress, it was still off the table. And yes, it's off the table by the Republicans too. Those are both parties that are dominated by wealth, to be quite honest. And we have studies that show that we are a plutocracy and our policies overwhelmingly benefit the wealthy. So neither one of those parties is going to give it to us. We have to push whoever is in office. The C stands for clarity. As I was saying before, there are going to be efforts to take us off track and derail us. I hate to say it, but another one that's being used is pushing people into state efforts instead of fighting at the national level because Congress members don't really want to take this on at the national level. And so they're telling people, just go do it in your states first. And we could have a whole conversation around that. But we have to be clear on what works and what doesn't. The Affordable Care Act was called universal, affordable, and guaranteed, and we knew in 2009 that it was never going to be any of those things. And the members of Congress knew that too. But it was really about political party and not about policy. The U stands for uncompromising. We are often told that politics is about compromise. But Gandhi said that when it comes to fundamentals, there is no compromise because it's all give and no take. So we literally cannot change our healthcare system to be about health until we get those profiteers out. Then there's a lot more work that we need to do. We need to get adequate resources, adequate primary care physicians, and there's a whole lot more. But fundamentally, the first step and the smallest incremental step is a national single-payer healthcare system. So I think of when we're told that we have to compromise is that they're trying to take our power away. And this has been the history of all social movements throughout time. They've always been told that they've been asking for too much. Women's rights, you're asking for too much. Ending child labor, you're asking for too much. You know, getting rid of the oil industry, you're asking for too much, right? So we can't let them take our power away because when we stay strong and true to what we're fighting for, we will win. And lastly, I just want to say, what will it mean when we win? And I say when we win because I believe that we will win this. It will be a radical transformation in the United States. It will mean that people's lives are more important than corporate profits. It will mean that every person living in the United States deserves the same level, the same high standard of health care. And it will create a social solidarity. This is one of the strengths of universal systems. And many of our, in other industrialized nations around the world recognize this, that a welfare system is always a poor system for the poor. But a universal system, because we are all in that system, and we are all fighting to make that the best system it is, and nobody can divide us and make us pit against each other, we lift up the quality of that system. And finally, it will empower us to recognize that we can take these fights on for our basic necessities, for our fundamental rights to education and jobs with a living wage and a livable future, that we can win these fights. It will empower us, and it will drive our public policy in a healthier direction. Because if you look at other countries that have universal systems, they don't poison their food, they don't poison their water, they don't poison their consumer products, they don't treat people the way that we do here in this country. So it will be a radical transformation. It's one that is going to be a fight, but it is a worthy fight, and now is absolutely the time to do it. And so I invite you, we have a campaign, healthoverprofit.org. There's a sign-up sheet on the back. It's all about giving you the tools to win this fight. And so I look forward to your questions, and thanks very much.
All right.
in the interest of time, we're going to hold the questions until after our next speaker. So, John, would you like to come on up and talk about the interview?
Good evening, everyone, and thank you for the opportunity to be here. Amy, thank you. Our Revolution and all of the sponsoring organizations, thank you. Dr. Flowers, thank you for that presentation. It was wonderful and very interesting to listen to. Seth, it's good to be with you again. We spent a lot of time in the spring together. And Frank, great to meet you tonight. And ladies and gentlemen, let me start by telling you one of the guiding philosophies of what I've believed in government and continue to, is that government exists to do those things that the private sector can't do. And there's a story that I'd like to tell you about that, because we learned this lesson in this country 200 years ago. Because about 200 years ago, we had a system in which the for-profit, the private sector, provided a vital government service, and it didn't work so well. About 200 years ago, if you were fortunate enough to own a home, one of the things that homeowners worried about back then, as they do today, although the concern was more acute back then, was fire. And the way you dealt with fire back then is you contracted with a private company. And if your home should catch on fire, you had a contract with a private company, they would come out and they would put your house out. Now, if you couldn't afford that insurance, and your home caught on fire, it wouldn't come out and put your fire out. And you'd watch your home burn to the ground. Now, if your neighbor had that insurance, like if your neighbor had an illness, your neighbor had that insurance, they would come out and they would water down your neighbor's home, so that your neighbor's home, who they were paid to protect, didn't burn down while your home burned down. That's kind of the system we have now with health insurance. It's because if you are fortunate enough to be able to buy it, if you have a job, then your fire gets put out. But if you're not, you get to watch the house burn down. And that really forms my philosophy in why I am an advocate for a single-payer healthcare system. There are so many reasons why we should do this. You can start with just the simple fact that we alone among the advanced economies in the world do not have a single payer healthcare system. We are the outlier. We are far by far the laggard when it comes to providing for the people of this country a system that guarantees healthcare. My daughter went on a junior semester abroad to the Netherlands, and something that she was unaccustomed to happened when she got off the plane. The very first thing she had to do once she cleared customs was to get a Dutch Social Security card, because while she was there, she was entitled to health care. They didn't ask where she was from, they didn't ask whether she could pay. She got a Dutch Social Security card. And when she left, she obviously had to turn it in, but it shows that their whole philosophy about health is different, because we understand this, that when we're in this room together, we are sharing the same space. And if you're not healthy and you're next to somebody who is, you're sharing things that perhaps you shouldn't be sharing. And that makes us all, no, I wasn't talking about you two, but they looked at each other. Maybe they
don't know. No, it's him I'm worried about.
But we're all in this together. And if we are all healthy, that inures to our benefit. And isn't this really the essence of one of the issues that confronts us today? And it's not just with healthcare. It's with a lot of aspects of government today. And that's why I believe the progressive movement is catching fire and is so successful. Because at its core, the whole thing about government is that it is an opportunity, it is an imperative for us to work together to help everyone, to help one another. And when we start thinking about these very vital services, whether it's healthcare or so many other things, and we look at it as to what's in it for me, we lose the very essence of what we are as a people. I recall one of my first public forums as a brand new assemblyman back in 1996. I went to my local senior center and I got asked the question about education and property taxes. And the person who got up was, you know, a known gadfly, rabble-rouser in the community. I was in office all of 6 months, and he wanted to know why I had not solved the property tax crisis in the 6 months I was in office. And you know, what was I taking my time for? It was an important issue, because he said that he had lived in this town for 70 years, and he had educated his children, and his children had gone on to college and had children of their own who had gone on to college, and he was tired of paying for other people's children. It was a travesty, he said, that he had to pay for other people's children. And so I said to him, I said, you know what? You're absolutely right. It is a travesty. And you know what else is a travesty? Is that at the time I was young, I was 40 years old, actually younger, and I said, you know, I don't think that by the time I hit retirement age, I'll be able to collect Social Security. Social Security Trust Fund is worse than our state pension fund. I'm really worried about it. Yet, every week when I get my paycheck, every other week, I'm paying a tax to go fund that system. And 98 cents of every dollar I pay into that system goes to pay your benefits. So I said to him, I said, I'll make you a deal. I said, you don't pay for my kids, and I won't pay for your benefits. And then he said, oh, no, wait. And so this is what we have to get our hands around. Because when we talk about why this is so troubling and vexing on a federal level, and even on a state level, is this notion that the collective good is only good when it benefits us. Mm. And if it benefits somebody else, well, then maybe it's time we think about something else. We have to get back to this fundamental notion that we're in this together. That for this government of ours, this representative democracy to work, we all have to have a collective sense of responsibility. And whether it's for educating our children or making sure we're all healthy, we're all in it together. And so that's why I introduced Assembly Bill 4945. Now, I will tell you, and I agree with you, Dr. Flowers, I would love to see 676 become law. I would love to see universal, single-payer health care, the law of all 50 states. But I look at what's happening in Washington. I see President 45 not really sure about exactly what he supports in health care. He was apparently in favor of what Representative MacArthur put forward when it passed the House, and now he's saying that it was horrible, and he's counting on the Senate. We saw Leader Schumer challenge the majority leader about how much time they would have to look at it, and he couldn't even answer that question. And so we see something is going to happen in Washington, and the concern that we all should have is, frankly, is that it's going to do some level of damage to the Affordable Care Act, which is not good for any of us. 500,000 more people in New Jersey insured by the Affordable Care Act. By no means a perfect piece of legislation, but better than what we had. And so, recognizing that we're not on the right track on the federal level, we need to at least start the process, and if the federal government fails, we should be in a place where we can enact a single-payer healthcare system here in New Jersey. And to be honest, it's awfully hard to do that. It's not easy. And I think we all ought to appreciate that, that what we're trying to do is very difficult. But that shouldn't dissuade us. That shouldn't be something that makes us pause and say, well, maybe we're biting off more than we can chew. Listen, I ran for governor. I know about biting off. But the fact of the matter is that the important fights are worth having. And the important fights are fights that you continue until you get it done right. And so we know that we need to start this discussion. We need to start looking at creating a single-payer healthcare system. And if the federal government can't do it, then we need to enact it here in New Jersey. And while there are people who will say in Trenton and elsewhere, John, you can't do that. That's just hard. I mean, I met with an editorial board, and the principal writer of the editorial board, and if he's watching, he knows who he is. He asked me this question. He kept saying, in a dismissive way, as to why this can't be done. Won't this require a massive, and he kept emphasizing the word, a massive increase in taxes. And I kept saying, but we're already paying that tax. When you look at what we're paying, in New Jersey alone, over $100 billion a year for healthcare. $100 billion. In a state that has a $35 billion pension problem and a $35 billion health benefits problem and a $50 billion transportation trust fund problem, big numbers are important. $100 billion for healthcare in New Jersey. And if you take that portion, the federal money and the state money will be there for a single-payer system. What we're really talking about is that section of that $100 billion pot that is private insurance, $45 billion a year. Think about it, $45 billion a year. Now, this goes back to the fire companies of 200 years ago that would only put out your house if you paid them. Because the insurance companies today are like those fire companies. They take the money in, but they only help those people who put the money in. And they ignore those who don't. And they let the fire get out of control. The fact is that when you look at that $45 billion going to the private insurance industry, and you recognize that, and I agree with the doctor's numbers, that something in the order of 15 to 20% of that amount is overhead. Not one penny of that amount is buying one Band-Aid, not providing one Advil, not buying one EpiPen. You understand how when we take matters in our own hands here in New Jersey, we can get that 3% overhead instead of the 20%, that 15 to 17% savings is money that goes back to the people of the state of New Jersey. And that's why single-payer health care is not only doable, it's an imperative. We can't afford to not do it because we will save so much money. But here's what we're up against. We're up against, as the doctor correctly pointed out, a medical, pharmaceutical, industrial complex that really likes things just the way they are. And they will spend a lot of time and money explaining to you why what we're talking about can't be done, that it's folly, that it's foolish, that it won't work. Because they get the benefit of that 20%. That's in their interest. But when we think about what happens to that 20%, not going to one person here in New Jersey not providing better care, when we think about the cost of pharmaceuticals, I mean, they're mind-boggling. My daughter uses an EpiPen, and she was diagnosed with her allergies probably 10 years ago. When she first had to get the EpiPen, I think the cost was about $500. It's now $750. And the raw materials in that pen are about $5. Now, I want you to know that when I had my first town hall, when I was running for governor, about this issue, and I talked about pharmaceutical prices, I got a call from the lobbying group. I did. I got a call from the lobbying group from the pharmaceutical industry. And they called to let me know that I had it wrong. But they said, but we really would appreciate it. They weren't so upset that I got it wrong. They said, okay, Wisniewski doesn't know what he's talking about. But they said, you want to talk to us first. Before you talk about healthcare.
May I check?
No, they offered me an admonition. They offered me an admonition. But so is it any wonder, when there was an opportunity in the U.S. Senate to vote for the importation of pharmaceuticals, cheaper pharmaceuticals from Canada, our two U.S. senators. Our two U.S. senators voted no. And their argument wasn't about cost, they said it was about safety. Because apparently, right. Did you know this, that Canada's people in Canada are suffering from cheap, illegal, unsafe pharmaceuticals? Of course
they
not.
They get money from the pharmaceutical companies.
And the other part is going back to the insurance industry. When your healthcare company is paying the insurance company, there's a little bit of back and forth between the insurance industry and the pharmaceutical industry. And that's where a single-payer healthcare system also makes it cheaper. And so this is a fight that's not optional. This isn't something that we're talking about that would be nice to do if we could. This is something that we have to do, because if we don't, this system will collapse upon itself. You know, we heard that the current way of dealing with healthcare through your employer is, you know, in chronological terms, relatively new, post-World War II. And that system worked early on, but it doesn't work now. I mean, when that system started out and you worked for one company for 35 years, and you retired and got a gold watch from that company, there was a lot more certainty with your health care than there is today. Sometimes you're lucky if you last 5 years, and sometimes they offshore the job someplace else. And so we have to decouple health care from employment, because health care ought to be a fundamental human right for everybody and not an economic choice. Opportunity, Amy and our Rev and all the sponsors, thank you for being up here. It's great to be on this panel, and I know that you probably are dying to ask some questions, so I'm going to yield the balance of my time and allow everyone to answer and ask questions. And again, thank you all very much. Appreciate it.
Thank you, John. So what we're going to do now, I failed to mention we're doing a live stream right now on Facebook. We're going to give a few minutes for questions, particularly for Assemblyman Wisniewski and Dr. Flowers. Then we're going to take a short break, and we'll come back and have some more speakers and some more discussion. I was remiss in thanking my partner here, Ariane Benefit, who put in countless hours of organization. She's responsible for all of the amazing handouts and organizing everything, so thank you, Ariane. Index cards. So if you have them, Al, would you just walk the room and collect if anybody has questions? If you'd like to ask a question yourself and have Facebook see you ask that question, come on up. And we're going to do just a few minutes and then take a short break. So would anybody like to come up and ask a question?
My name is Ted Glick. I work with the Green Party in Essex County. This is a t-shirt, by the way, was made by a Green Party member. It's a nice t-shirt. My question is for Mr. Wisniewski. There's only one candidate running for governor who supports single-payer health care. And you were also Bernie Sanders' leader here last year. And a lot of people think that Seth Copperdale is kind of this year's Bernie Sanders in New Jersey. Maybe you were, but unfortunately I didn't win. So my question is, will you be endorsing Seth Copperdale?
Oh, on the spot. Wow. Well,
this is a forum on single-payer healthcare. So I'm gonna sidestep the endorsement question for the moment. You know, we came up today, and you know, Seth and I are friends, and we've developed a friendship over 7.5 months of campaigning in a lot of the same forums, and I have a lot of respect for him. But you know, my goal right now, post primary election, is to make sure that we're moving 49-45 through the assembly, making sure that we have all the necessary resources. Assembly ends in 7 months. I want to try to take every advantage to make sure that I can move this piece of legislation to a successful conclusion during that time. But thank you.
In fairness, I'm going to read a question from a card and then we'll come back to the audience. So if the AHCA, otherwise known as Trump Care, passes, the states will have to take responsibility for those on Medicaid who will be kicked off. What are states going to do, and maybe perhaps we could say New Jersey, without the funds that they would have had under the Affordable Care Act? How can states implement a new program, single payer, if they don't have that funding coming in if AHCA gets rid of it? So,
sure, I don't want to monopolize it, and I'll certainly defer to everybody else. This is one of the fundamental reasons why we see that the state-based single-payer system has to be on the table as a possibility for New Jersey. We really don't know exactly what's going to come out of Washington. We heard, you know, one version come out of the House praised and then panned, and now a second version coming out of the Senate without any certainty as to what's going to be included in it. But New Jersey's going to have to, in a Trump world, in a Trump environment, is going to have to stand up, and we are collectively going to have this conversation with our friends and our neighbors and our brothers and our sisters about what do we value in New Jersey, what is important to us, because far too often the conversation often turns to, well, that's very expensive. I don't know that we can do that. That would be hard. All of these things are hard because, quite frankly, it pushed a lot of these tough decisions so far down the road that there are no easy decisions left. But having people in this state go without medical care because of a decision made in Washington, D.C. that benefits the top 0.1% in this country is not something that any leader in this state ought to stand by and allow happen, and that's why I'm continuing to push the single-payer system.
So one thing that you might want to consider as a state is look to your neighbors in Connecticut. So most states have their Medicaid run by a variety of what are called managed care organizations. They're actually private insurance companies like Aetna, UnitedHealth, WellPoint, whatever. States that have looked at those MCOs have found that they're actually taking about 40 to 50% of the Medicaid dollars off the top for themselves. And so Connecticut was the first state to just kick them all out and do a purely public Medicaid, and they've been able to bring their administrative costs down significantly and cover more benefits of more people. Oklahoma is another state that did that and found that it improved the benefits and the coverage they could provide. So that would be a step that you at the state level can do that would help to preserve a lot of that Medicaid funding.
Try one from the floor. Gentleman in the purple shirt, do you want to come up? Please, so.
Thank you. My name is Michael Amador. I live in Harrington Park, and I work as an administrative assistant for New Jersey's largest agency that provides supportive services for homeless and near homeless veterans, Community Hope. My question is for Dr. Flowers, and it has to do with costs. In last year's campaign, Bernie Sanders was proposing $33 trillion to basically convert our system to single payer, which, by the way, I'm a big supporter of. He only proposed $15 trillion in taxes. So let's say if we save X amount of money through all the other savings through the system that winds its way down, you're at the $22 to $24 trillion mark. So we're close to $10 trillion short of the money that we need. And we already discussed how with pharmaceuticals, we try to get savings there and there's resistance, right? So my question is, when the average country around the world only pays their doctors, let's say for the top 10 countries in the world pay their doctors for general practitioners $90,000 or $150,000 on average for their specialists. How do you tell general practitioners or specialists, especially in the New York metro area, that, well, if we're like any other country in the world, we're only going to be able to pay you X amount of dollars, and this is what they pay in other countries in the world?
Thanks for that question. I'm not sure where you got your numbers from, but basically, we have the most expensive system in the world right now because we don't bargain for fair prices for health services or for pharmaceuticals because we don't have a system. A single-payer system makes us called a single purchaser or a monopsony so that we actually can negotiate for fair prices, and that's where we estimate that in terms of pharmaceutical prices alone, we could save over $100 billion a year. By negotiating those prices. And then the administrative costs, we're spending a third of our healthcare dollars above what the insurance companies are taking, which they admit that they're taking 18 to 20% off the top, is that you have hospitals and health professionals' offices that are spending huge amounts of money. I think in 2010, the AMA did a study and found that the average doctor per doctor in a practice is spending $70,000 a year on billing. So that's a huge amount of money that would no longer need to be there. My friends who practice in France don't even have a billing office. They just submit through the computer their form to the state, you know, and they get paid within 5 days, which is, that'd be amazing. So there have been study after study after study that has been done that has shown that this current system is unsustainable, that it's going to continue to rise and eat into our GDP, and that the only way we can get control of those healthcare costs is through a single-payer system. And I often think about, and I spend a lot of time in Congress, and a funny thing down there is that whenever that they want money for war, another bomber, you know, even things we don't need, like the F-35, or in my state where we found $3 billion to build a blimp that flew away and knocked out all the power lines in Pennsylvania, you know, there's no question, there's never a question there about, you know, where are we going to get the money. So there are studies that show that we can afford this and show that it will actually bend the cost curve over time. So, you know, I'm not concerned about that. Oh, but the doctors being paid. Sorry, one quick thing. Is that doctors actually paid very well. Like in Canada, when I look at what the pediatricians are making up there, I practiced as a pediatrician for 17 years, and they're making like $200,000+ a year. I never made that. You know, and I was working really hard. So, you know, I think that we're going to find that particularly for the primary care docs, who are very underpaid in this country, they're going to do fine because we know that a strong healthcare system has a strong primary care backbone. The specialists, maybe the orthopedists and the anesthesiologists are not going to make $3 million a year. I think that they'll still be just fine and comfortable. You know, so.
And just to piggyback on the doctor's answer is that, you know, one of the things that should also be front and center in this discussion is that surveys around the world of satisfaction by physicians with their practice, with what they do. There's one place in the world where the medical professionals rank in the lowest quartile in satisfaction. It's here in the United States. And the reason they cite is that they are not able to be practitioners of healing arts. They are required to be accountants and bookkeepers and financial analysis, and the list goes on. And so one of the things that a single-payer healthcare system does is it frees up our providers to actually do what they went to school, what they trained to do, is to be providers. Not to be bookkeepers and accountants.
Yes.
excuse me. Very quickly, in HR 676, I believe there are provisions for as they allocate money, it's on a regional basis. It does take into account cost of living for practitioners. The other thing that I would say is, I'll give you my email address. Very simple. FPUIK3@gmail.com, because I've studied the financing of this pretty well, so that if you have any questions with regard to how it's done, you can simply email me and I'll give you a response.
Okay, I'm going to do one more question, and then we're going to take like a 3-minute break, and I'm going to be biased and ask my friend Amy to come on up.
doctor, but anyone, could you talk about how our healthcare system and insurance system now, and pharmaceutical setup, are fueling the opioid crisis and then failing to treat the victims of that crisis?
Wow. Yes.
That's a great question. I'm not an expert in that area, but I was in West Virginia not too long ago speaking to groups there who told me that the pharmaceutical companies who make the opioids have shifted tremendous amounts into that state and then set up clinics that are open on the days after people typically get paid, and that there's, you know, a huge kind of collusion there and you know, kind of really encouraging and enabling people to get easy access to opioids and to use them. And then, yeah, I wanted to piggyback off something that that Mr. Wisniewski said, is that, you know, doctors are, in the United States, are actually burning out, especially primary care docs, in like 10 to 15 years under this current system. I made it for 17. And committing suicide at a higher rate than the general population, because we're literally working in a system that cares nothing about health. And so you see your patient and you spend time with them and you want them to get what they need, and then you find out that they can't because the system won't let them. And I also see that level of despair happening in the United States, and I think that's fueling the opioid crisis as well, because we don't take care of each other. And we have record levels of economic insecurity. All the recovery pretty much went to the top. People are living, even people who have a job, are, you know, at risk of losing it. So I just think that, you know, again, this is a reason why we really need to start standing up together and saying, no, we have the means in this country. Our GDP is growing. Our wealth is growing. We could take care of each other. But that's not going to happen until we stand together and demand it.
Okay, so we're going to halt the Facebook stream for just a couple of minute break. We'll be back with a new broadcast. And there's snacks, restrooms over there or downstairs. We'll come back in about 5 minutes, and keep your questions in mind for the next half.
I'm Jenna. I'm Jenna.